thought I had what I can read, but in the verse that I want to read today, and I want to back it up with another verse, but it says, Romans 12, verse 2 says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Think about that reminder. We're called to be transformed. You know, it says we're to have the mind of Christ. If you go back to Romans 8, you know, I want you to understand why it's so critical to have your mind transformed. And we do this, I want to point out, we do this by hearing the Word and by reading the Word, by being in the Word. You know, that's how we do it. You know, we're in the world every day, and the world's always trying to keep us stuck doing. But we have to get out of that world sometimes, spend time with Him.
Amen.
Allow Him to come in and teach us. Romans chapter 8 says, verse 6 says, "For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is at enmity with God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can it be." See, our natural mind, our carnal mind, is at war with God. It says, at enmity with God. It's at war with Him, and we're trying to resist doing what the Spirit wants. But we have to ask the Spirit to come in and teach us, and guide us, take control of us. So that's why it's so critical for us to be transformed. The word actually comes from a word in the Greek that is morph, metamorphosis. We hear, you know, like a butterfly changes from that caterpillar into the butterfly. That's how our mind is supposed to be. It's supposed to be morphed from how we think in the flesh to the Spirit. You know, how God thinks. What God says, you know, we walk by faith, not by sight.
Man.
A lot of times, if we think about it, it doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Won't you stand and worship with us? Just invite the Holy Spirit in to touch your heart. We open the door. Hallelujah. Praise your name, Lord.
Oh, Lord, my God. I'm
Lord. You are Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
We praise you.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I could Thank you. peace I leave with you, not as the world gives, but as I give, my shalom peace, nothing missing, nothing broken.
God is so good. I love His sweet presence, don't you?
Amen.
Thanks for the special music you have this morning.
It was wonderful.
I have a testimony.
Yes.
My brother was going to come to service last week, and Mike and I were going to pick him up, and he was hospitalized, cancer care in Marion. And Roxanne and Mike went over and ministered to him. And he was released yesterday.
Praise
the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
He brought you so much. And I just thank all the medical personnel that we're so blessed in this country. That
yes, we are.
I know my wife went through so much, and it wasn't for the personnel and the loving care that she's received and my brother's received, she wouldn't have been there as long as she was. And
I remember always saying that she felt like a fan Christian.
Yeah, that's for sure.
She was sticking her. She She's a strong woman.
Amen.
She was a strong woman.
Thank you, Jesus.
She kept pressing on and pressing on. And it was hard for her sometimes to put a smile on her face, but she did.
You know, she actually cheered up people. That...
Yes, she did. She cheered me up. Yes, she
Amen.
Did. And I know she was in pain, you know, and she's very strong. When I get down sometimes, I think of Judy a lot, because she strengthens me. Hallelujah. We were going through a teaching on the walk to Emmaus. I was just kind of looking over some things. And not too sure how much I'm going to have today. I was working on it, and Mike came in and said, you know, you got practice this morning. I'm like, oh! But this is going to be the fifth kind of teaching on it. And then I don't know, you know, the next couple weeks, we'll see what God gives me for Easter, but the Resurrection Sunday. But Philippians, I think it's 6, says this. Now I'm sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Bring it to completion. Was the cross the end?
No.
No. The cross wasn't the end, was it? But everybody kind of thought it was. The cross wasn't the end. Was the grave the end? Put in the grave? Was that the end? You all hear me? I don't think I got my microphone. I'm not what you call a seasoned pastor. Got everything together, so. I hope that's okay. Yeah, I'm human. Cross wasn't the end, and neither was the grave. When Jesus hung on the cross, who was there with him? That y'all remember? Two thieves, right? One on one side, one on the other side. And the one on one side mocked him, right? He said, if you're the Son of God, come down off that cross. At his time that he was hurting the most, mocked him. And the other one chose to believe. Luke 23:41-43 says this. We are punished justly, that's what this thief was saying. For we are receiving what we deserve for our actions, but this man, ain't talking to Jesus, has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. Remember me. Don't forget me. Remember me. He chose to believe me. Now, something sparked faith in that thief. And Jesus said to him, truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. You know, let's look at this. I have to keep my finger on this because it all went together. I had it all spread out, but it all went together when I emailed it. But anyway, let's look at this like, yeah, Jesus is in the center, right? There used to be an old song called Jesus in the Center of It All or something like that. And Jesus was in the center. And one was on the left, one was on the right. Okay, let's look at this for a moment as one was your past, one was your future. Jesus is in the middle of it all. He's in the center of your life, right?
That's a good word.
He's in the center. So the past would be that old self, that old sinner, that old one that done everything wrong, said, you know, hurt people, stole, lied, did things, bad things to little kids. That old self, you know, that old self. Past. Jesus is in the center. Now let's say that you're forgiven for your sins. Now you've got future to look forward to. He said, today you will be with me in paradise. He didn't say, well, maybe. We'll see how you do. We'll see how you do. You see, we always think that God's with us as long as we are good. As long as we obey his word. As long as we don't cuss, as long as we don't drink, as long as we don't steal, as long as we do all the things, you know, that the Ten Commandments say, as long as we do all those things, God's with us, right? But I want to tell you something, God's with you even if you're doing bad things, even if you're stuck in an addiction, even if you're stuck in something that you want to get out of desperately, but you feel like you're hold to it and you're bound to it. God is with you even there. He's with you. He's in the center of your life. Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Remember them? Remember old Nebuchadnezzar? He wanted them to bow down to that golden idol. And they weren't going to do it. They weren't going to do it. And so old Nebuchadnezzar, he tied them up. He threw them in there bound. Threw them in there on the ground bound. Well, remember what happened? Remember what happened? Then after that, he said, I seen them stood up. See, he threw men down. You may be down. You may be down with something, but you're going to stand up. Threw men bound. He seen them stand up, loosed, walking around. And who was in the center of it all? Jesus. Amen. Jesus was in the center of it all. He was in the center of the fire. And they were walking around, loosed. Jesus was in the center of the two crosses. Then I got to thinking, you know, it takes two beams to make that cross. And how Jesus wants us to have relationships with each other. The road to Emmaus, when these two people, Cleo, and a lot of people think it was his wife, but we don't know that for sure, but just for, you know, today I'll say Cleo and his wife, Cleopas and his wife on the road to Emmaus, and they were talking back and forth, and when they finally realized it was Jesus, they had decided this between the two of them. You see, it took them talking to each other. It's much like when we have a board, like in a church or some organization that you need a board. They call that wise counsel when you're talking. You talk beneath each other. You make a decision beneath each other. You talk. You communicate. It takes two people. And come to the right decision. So Jesus wants relationships, and we know that because of his life on earth, don't we? I mean, he walked and he talked. He had 12 disciples that he picked, and he taught and he healed and he ministered to everyone. He loved everyone. There's not one person he turned away. And he kind of held these 12 people close to him. So we can see that he wants us to have relationships. Right? He wants us to communicate with each other. Because, what is it? Iron sharpens iron, as the word says. We need each other to help us grow spiritually. Because if we don't talk, hey, you know, this is what I think the scripture is saying because of this word. And if you look here in this word and you go here in the Strong's, it means this, like metamorphosis, transformation. We need to be communicating with one another like that so the other person can say, oh, okay, I got it now. I understand. But there's a lot of us today in the church that would choose to just be a loner, come to church,
not have any friends, not talk to anybody, just come, get the word, go home. Me and God, he understands me, we got it going on. I hear this sometimes from someone I know close. He knows me. You know, he understands me, but yet they choose never to walk into a church building, hardly ever pick up the Bible and read it. You see, what have they done? They've made their own God. They've made their own God. They've made their own idol, and their God is going to allow them to do anything they want to do because he's their God. When we have friends, we have those that we communicate with in the church body. We cry together. We laugh together. We pray together. We cut up together. You know, sometimes when we practice worship, sometimes we cut up a little bit. Well, Carl grabs mandolin, he'll start doing something. And Jeff, he'll start playing classic rock or something like that. And you know what? That's okay. It's okay to enjoy each other's company. It's okay to cut up. Act crazy. And if you have close friends sometimes, and I'm sure this has happened to everybody. If you have close friends sometimes those friends can let you down. Sometimes those friends can stab you in the back. And it hurts really bad. And then sometimes, if we are not careful, and we don't learn to forgive, we become wounded and we become offended. And what we do is we build a wall. I don't let anybody else in there. Nobody's going to hurt me again like that. And when we do that, we're not totally forgiving. We're not totally allowing the love of Jesus to forgive that person. You know how God's taught me a lot in that area, and I've walked through that fire, believe me. I've walked through that fire, and boy, it's hurt. It has hurt. But when you can honestly say, oh, I forgive that person. You know, you hear that all the time. I forgive them. But then you go the other way when you see them in the grocery store, and you avoid them every chance you get. You can forgive them, but you don't have to hang around with them, right? He has given me, you know, when you learn to let go of that offense and love through the eyes of Jesus, you can honestly say, I love you. I'm going to talk to you. You know, they may still have a problem with me, or you might still have somebody have a problem with you or whatever, but when you look through the eyes of Jesus and just love them, and you get it, you get it. Because see, sometimes it takes that conflict that's happened between you, that misunderstanding that's happened between you, to grow you. God works all things together for good. So even though something might happen that's bad between you and another person, God is going to use that to grow you spiritually. And you're going to come out brighter on the other end. I know, I feel like I have. I feel like God has let me love, you know, the ones who have hurt me. And I don't feel that, how dare her, or how dare him. I don't feel that anymore. And I used to. Mike used to hear me go on and on and on about how, you know, somebody did something to me, and I did only but love them, and I didn't understand. And you know, sometimes he'd say sometimes to me, I didn't say things right, because I'm not, you know, what you'd say a wise person when it comes to speaking, but sometimes I don't understand, or when I say something, somebody else can take it the wrong way, and I don't understand how I said it. To me, it didn't come out that way. But he's corrected me a couple times, and that's okay, because I don't know unless somebody tells me. You know, I don't know if something's wrong unless you say, hey, you know what, that's I don't like that. Gotta let me know. Just like they gotta let you know, right? You have two friends, and you're real close, and something about one of your friends just really burns you, and they keep doing it, And yet that friend don't know that it offends you. Well, they're not going to know unless you open your mouth and say something. And then they have a chance to let that go, forgive, and move on. Jesus will always show up in the middle of the situation to complete his promise for you. Hallelujah. We all got a destiny. We all got a promise. We all got a purpose. Every one of us. God has that in us. And it's up to us to fulfill that. But see, we got to be sold out. We can't be playing around. We got to be sold out to him. Sold out to God. Let him guide your whole life. You know, sometimes you're going to run across people that you just don't want to be around. But you have to let God guide you. All the people that spat on him when he walked across. All the people that whipped him when he walked across the road. Do you think he wanted to do that? Didn't he cry in the Garden of Gethsemane, Father, if there's any other way, if there's any other way, Father, let this cup pass from me. He didn't want to go to the cross if there was another way. Was the only way. Why was it? Jesus was pure love. Something that we will never understand. Pure love. Not tatted, not tattered, but anything. Pure. 100% love. Love. You know, this is getting off the message, but you know, years ago, and I'm pretty blunt in my preaching, so I hope I don't offend anybody, but years ago, when I was younger, I was raped, and I used to hate that man. I used to lie awake at night, have nightmares, and hate him, wanted to kill him. If I seen him, I'd kill him. I mean, I just wanted to kill him, and it affected me for years. It affected my marriage. Because you feel filthy. There's no other way to put it. You just feel filthy. You want to take showers after showers after showers. And then it gets to the point where you can't clean yourself enough. But anyway, I turned into an alcoholic, and all of you guys know that. And through working the steps, Jesus found me again. And it was the steps are the Word of God, as far as I'm concerned. Recovery is all about the Bible, coming back to Him. Well, anyway, they said, pray for Him. Through working the steps, my sponsor was a spiritual woman. She was saved. She was a Christian. And I chose her because she was a Christian. And she said, pray for Him. And I'm like, huh? What? What are you talking about? Pray for Him? I want to kill him. I mean, can you think of somebody doing something to your little girl, your son, your granddaughter? I mean, think of that, I guess. And you want to kill him. You don't want to forgive him. You don't want to pray for him. And she kept saying, pray for him. We're not moving on to the next step until you pray for him. Well, it took me a long time to get through step four. Long time. Long, long time. And so I got down on my knees and I was mad at God, and I was like, I don't understand this. Why do I gotta pray for him? You know, I don't understand. But yet the Bible does say, pray for your enemies. Right? Well, he was an enemy as far as I'm concerned, about the lowest enemy you could get. So I got down on my knees and I prayed. And I continued to pray. Now, I'm not saying that I prayed hard for him. First, it was like, Father, I forgive him. But I really don't. I forgive him. But I really don't. It was something like that. And I did say the words out loud. I forgive him. But I really don't. I give it, and then I take it back. I give it, and then I take it back. I give it, and then I take it back. But after the process of doing it over and over and over again, it got to where one day I said, I forgive him. And I didn't say, and I take it back. And I kept saying, I forgive him. And then the Lord showed me something. The Lord showed me that man as a little boy, and his dad would molest him and would bring other men in. And I know this is really gross, and I crave a lot, but this is where the healing takes place, to be with that child. Now, I don't understand a lot of that, and I didn't. I was very naive to a lot of stuff that went on behind closed doors, you know. But even back then, back in olden days, it went on. And I know up in the hills, where my mom comes from, a lot of it went on between brother and sister and stuff. I mean, you know, it happened. It happened in Bible days. I don't mean to offend anybody. It happened. But what I'm saying is, we need to forgive. And sometimes God will bring us to that place. To that place. And there's nobody that understands that kind of forgiveness except for Jesus Christ. Because he forgave all that sin. All of it when he hung on the cross. Let's think of this a minute. Here's Jesus. He's went to the cross. All his friends, people he trusted, people he thought, man, if I ever need anything right there, they're going to be right there by my side. They're going to help me. You know, I taught them all I know. They're going to be right there because they honor me, right? I taught them everything they know, so they're going to be right there by the teacher's hand. He's hanging on that cross. He's looking down. Who does he see? Who does he see? Does he see all 12 of them? No. No, he doesn't. They forsake him. They left him. They left him hanging there. Who was there? Mary. John. And his mother. And I was thinking, man, that was me. Gosh, I'd be so mad. I'd be so mad at all of them for leaving me, you know? The only thing that came to my mind, and this is because I've been in alcoholic stuff, you know, is that when I know... Sometimes when I was in a bar and I used to drink so much, even my friends couldn't get me to come. Because for some reason, you just didn't want to leave the, I don't know, they'd leave you there. Well, you know, when you're a woman and your friends desert you and they leave you there, what's going to happen? Anybody know a bar scene? All the men are going, like vultures. You know, Jesus suffered more than we will ever, ever know. He took all that junk in my life. And I don't know what all you have, but he took all that too. All the generation after generation after generation, he took it. And as long as you've asked forgiveness in your heart, for him to come in your heart, he loves you and he's forgiven you, and that curse is broken. You got it? Somebody needs to hear that today. Because they've heard a lot about generational curses. And I want to tell you something. When that teaching was popular, I sat in the church and I thought, oh no, I'll never get free. If I have to go through all that generational stuff they're talking about, I have all this stuff in my family line, I'll never be free. Oh God, I'm hopeless. Jesus spoke to me, and he said, honey, when I came in, I loosed it all. Hallelujah. All you have to do is receive it.
Hallelujah.
when you ask Jesus in your heart, that curse is broken. When Jesus came in the fire, that curse was broken. Those shackles were loosed off their hands. They didn't have that. They weren't bound anymore. You're not bound anymore when Jesus comes in your heart. You just got to learn to receive it. Quit thinking about the past. Let the past be the past. Think about the future. Think about the future with Christ. The future with Him. Don't go back there and wallow around in that. Because that's what Satan wants you to do. Think toward the future. The future is always creative. Boop, boop, glory. You know, the Holy Spirit is so colorful. He is so beautiful. So beautiful, I'm telling you. And He'll give you creative thoughts. He'll give you ideas. There'll be things pop in your head that you don't even know where they came from. But if you put it in action, it works. Right? Hallelujah. So when Jesus looked down at John, well, now it turns around. He looks down and he's telling John, this is your mom. And you know, did you think he really needed to say that? John loved Jesus. And Jesus loved John. And when he said, John, let this be your mom, he was saying, take care of her. You know, make sure you look out for her, take care of her, be a family. He probably didn't need to say that. John probably would have did it anyway, don't you think? But I found it interesting that John, he was always the one that said, I'm the one that Jesus loves. Sometimes you'll hear people say that. I said it yesterday at the cash register. I went to Carlson's and I was getting some makeup, and she blessed me with a free sample, and she was out of the other one, so she gave me two instead of one. I said, well, Jesus just loves me. And she looked at me like, there's something wrong with me. But when someone says, Jesus loves me, people like, what? When you know Jesus loves you, then you can stand confident in that, right? Amen. Well, John knew that. He knew that Jesus loved him because he always said it. And here's John standing at the cross looking up at Jesus, and his hope is dying right there on the cross, see? And the promise on the cross, dying. And you know, everybody left when things started getting rough. Everybody skedaddled. But John didn't. You see, he had the faith to look beyond all circumstances because Jesus had said he was going to come in his glory, right? So when he was looking up at Jesus, I suppose he was thinking to himself, he loves me. I love him. He loves me. I love him. And even though it looks like it's the end, it's not. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't understand the situation. But I have a hope. Because Christ in me, the hope of glory. See, he knew. He already had Christ in his heart. He knew that Jesus was already there in his heart. Christ in me, the hope of glory. He had a hope of his glory, his resurrection glory. Now, when Jesus resurrected and he showed himself, can you imagine John's face when he seen him? I knew it! That'd be what I would be thinking. I knew it! I knew it was going to happen. I knew it. I had the faith. I could see through love eyes. Love eyes. He looked at Jesus with love. He stood with him when no one else would stand with him, right? Now sometimes when you're with other friends, other Christians, sometimes there comes a point you got to stand with somebody. You may not know what to say to them. John, I imagine John and Mary at one point, after all the words were spoken, all they could do would be just stand with him. What would you do? Walk away? They stood until he passed away. They stood their ground with me. And sometimes you got to do that with a friend. Sometimes you got to do that with a husband. Sometimes you have to do that with a wife. You stand with them. You stand with them. You may not have words to say, but you can stand. Right? Hallelujah. You know, I was thinking about on the road to Emmaus, and I know I'm getting kind of off, but I was thinking about, you know, how much technology now, people will text each other even when someone else is in the other room. They'll text, hey, can you come in here and get me a pop or whatever, instead of just going and saying that. They'll text it on the phone. And how much we don't communicate to one another. Now, texting's good, but there's one thing that texting leaves out when you're texting somebody, and that's the tone of your voice. Unless you record it and send it to them that way. But sometimes there can be really big misunderstandings between each other when you're texting because they take it the wrong way when it's not meant that way at all. Jesus will always be in the center of our life. And we have to give everything to Him. When He looked down at John and John looked at Him, He knew that one got it. You see, and this is important to me. I say this a lot sometimes. If I can help just one, it's worth it. It's worth it. If you can reach just one, it's worth it. Jeff, if you can reach just one person with a worship song that your fingers play and it touches their heart and they're swayed to talk to Jesus, it's worth it. It's worth it. Right, Carl?
Exactly.
Anything I say can touch somebody's heart. It's worth it. It's worth it. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Next week I'm probably going to talk a little bit about the cross and what happened after that. But I want you to know Jesus is always in the center of everything. Past, the future, is right in the middle. And He died for it all. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So you remember that. Don't be so hard on yourself. God is good. God is good. Well, I'd like to ask Diane and Sue to come up and let's pray. They've been having some sickness in their life. And God's going to touch them. Amen.
Amen.
And then we'd like to take up a special offering for... what's your name again, sir?
Gene.
He is in need of a little bit of help. And if you want to give to that, just put it on the table, and we will see that he gets it. Diane and Sue would like to come up. And you all can pray. You can raise your hands and pray, or you can come up. You have no power over her. You boost her in the name of Jesus. I pray in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, have your way in her heart. Flood her with your love, Lord. Just flood her with your kisses. Oh, hallelujah, Father God. We ask that you dance around her, Lord. That you, your word says that you sing over her, God. And I just pray that she feels that love, Lord. I pray that you would let her whole body come back into perfect love. virus, that you would be gone in the name of Jesus. You have no control over her body, and you will not stay here. You're not going to hang around. No, you're not going to hang around. You're not going to come here, go there, come here, go there. You're going to go right now in the name of Jesus. You have no power over her body. You have no control over her body because we don't give you permission. Jesus Christ, owns the power. Lord, we just ask that you would just bless her, Lord. We ask that you would touch her. We ask that you heal her completely, Father God. We ask that she would feel your love, Holy Spirit, that she'd feel you dancing around her and singing over her, Lord. And she'd have a light-hearted spirit, Lord, just like a child again, Father God. Lord, let her not hear harsh words, but let her hear only love words from you, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Guys are good.
Yeah.
We have a basket in the back for offerings. If you would like to give offering.
Oh, tell me.
Oh, that's Jackie. She's talking about that.